Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to the First Congregational Church in Essex, United Church of Christ, for Sunday worship. Most of you know me. My name is Jeff Birch. I'm a seminarian at Lexington Theological Seminary in Lexington, Kentucky. And as you probably have noticed, this is not Lexington, Kentucky. I study online most of the time, and since COVID, I've been studying online pretty much all the time. So I'm also a member in discernment in the United Church of Christ, and I am under the care of this congregation. So it is a double and triple pleasure to be here with you all today. I'm so pleased to have been asked to lead you in worship today and be the first person who gets to preach to you and with you and pray with you in this new season of the church as we move towards our new time and our new minister. It's fitting that Christians around the world are approaching the season of Advent, and here at Essex, of course, we are approaching our own Advent, our own renewal, our own rebirth. So, and we'll talk a little bit about some of that in the sermon today. It's remarkable. I mean, the transformation of the leaves, the transformation of the seasons, the way that the sanctuary is the same and yet different, with microphones and cameras and TVs and so forth. It's a new day. My friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is our day of Advent. This is our day of new beginnings. Let's take a moment on this day of new beginning and greet each other with a hearty welcome and the love of Christian fellowship. Let's take a minute to do that now. Hello. Get my mask back on. I'm all messed up here. I realize the gain on my mic is pretty high, so I'm trying not to talk too loud, which is very much an effort for me because I tend to talk loud. So I think we're ready to move on. If you'll actually, our first hymn is a seated hymn. So if you'll join us together in singing the wonderful hymn number 417 in the black hymnal. Thank you. that. If you'll rise for the opening prayer. There is a richness here, richness that greets and grows and holds and challenges and keeps. There is a richness here,
a richness that surrounds and brings and delivers and gives.
The richness holds us in our weakness, fills us in our hunger. Let this time together inspire us in richness and grace.
Thank you.
Well, I scheduled a children's moment for this, but we don't have any children here. But I do have some designated children, so they're going to come down, and we're going to do this. So I need to get now, I just turned 60, so this could be dangerous for me to sit down like this. Well, hello.
Hello.
How are you?
Fine. How are you?
So today we're going to talk about some people and characters in the Old Testament. Now, we almost never do that here at this church. And I'll be honest with you, I've been to a lot of churches in the last year, and mostly we don't talk about the Old Testament stories very much at all. But we are today, and I brought the church's big Bible, right? It's normally back there. And we're going to be in the book of Samuel. And there's a couple, and we're going to watch a video about it here in just a minute, so I don't want to give away too much of the cool stuff you're going to get to see in the video. But the story of Samuel talks about a time after the Israelites came out of Egypt, but before they had a king. So in that period of time in there, after they've moved into the land that God promised them, but before they had a king. So that's the period of time that this part's talking. And this is going to be at the very beginning of that story. And it's going to be talking about one of the very first prophets that the Jewish people had. And that prophet's name was Samuel. And so we're going to hear a little bit about Samuel's call and when God first talked to Samuel and what Samuel was going to do about that. So it's a pretty neat story, like a lot of stories in the Old Testament. It's a little scary because it talks about God being mad at people, you know, and we don't always talk too much about that, but that's a big part of our legacy too, right? Is God trying to help us to get things right and do things right and be right and to help us know when God is calling us. So if you want to, I would tell you, you could go sit cross-legged over there, but probably not. And anyway, I'm going to invite you to sit over here where you can see the TV. And choir, if you want to come down to see the TV, I'll show you this video. There, I made it. And we'll watch this video on the TV about this first.
The books of 1 and 2 Samuel. They're two separate books in our modern Bibles, but that division is due simply to scroll length. It was originally written as one coherent story. We're just going to cover the book of 1 Samuel in this video. So after Israel was rescued from slavery in Egypt, they made a covenant with God at Mount Sinai and eventually came into the Promised Land. And there, Israel was supposed to be faithful to God and obey the covenant commands. Before the book of Samuel, Judges showed how Israel failed at that task big time. It was a period of moral chaos, and it showed Israel's need for wise, faithful leaders. The book of Samuel provides an answer to that need. The book of Samuel's story focuses on three main characters: the prophet Samuel, where the book gets its name, and then King Saul, and after that, King David. And all three of them transitioned Israel from a group of tribes ruled by judges into a unified kingdom ruled by King David in Jerusalem. And the book of Samuel has a fascinating design that weaves the story of these three characters together in four main parts. Samuel, he's the key leader and prophet in the first section of the book, but then he also plays a key role in the next section, which is Saul's story, and it's told in two movements: Saul's rise to power and then his failures, and the second part is about his downfall and his tragic death. And then the drama of Saul's demise is matched by David's exciting rise to power. And then David's story is told in two movements. First, he rides the wave of his success, followed by his own tragic failure and the slow self-destruction of his family and then his kingdom. The book concludes with an epilogue that reflects back over the whole story. So let's dive in and see how this all unfolds. Part one picks up from the chaos of the book of Judges, and we're introduced to a touching story about a woman named Hannah. And she's grieved because she has never been able to have children. And by God's grace, she finally has a son named Samuel. And in joy, she sings this amazing poem in chapter 2. And the poem is all about how God opposes the proud and exalts the humble, about how despite tragedies and human evil, God is working out his purposes in history. And also it's about how God will one day raise up an anointed king for his people. Now, Hannah's poem has been placed here at the beginning of the book to introduce these key themes that we're going to see throughout the whole story, like the next one. Samuel grows up and becomes a great prophet and leader for the people of Israel, at the same time that the Philistines rise to power as Israel's arch nemesis. And in this crucial battle, the Israelites get arrogant, and instead of praying and asking God for help, they trot out the Ark of the Covenant as this kind of magic trophy that will automatically grant them victory in battle. And so because of their arrogant presumption, God allows Israel to lose the battle and the ark is stolen. So the Philistines, they take the ark and they place it in the temple of their god, Dagon. And then the God of Israel defeats the Philistines and the god Dagon without an army by sending plagues on the people. And then the Philistines don't want the ark anymore, obviously, and they send it back to Israel. And the point of this little story seems to be this. God is not Israel's trophy, and he opposes pride among the Philistines, but also among his own people. And so Israel needs to remain humble and obedient if they want to experience God's covenant blessing, which opens up into the next large section. The Israelites come to Samuel and they say, hey, we want a king like all the other nations have. Go find one for us. And so Samuel, he's kind of ticked off and he goes to consult with God. And God says, yes, their motives are all wrong, but if a king is what they want, give them one. And so we're introduced to the figure of Saul. Now, Saul is a tragic figure because he begins full of promise. He's tall, he's good looking, he's a perfect candidate for a king, but he has deep character flaws. He's dishonest, he lacks integrity, and he seems incapable of acknowledging his own mistakes. And so these flaws become his downfall. He wins some battles at the beginning, but his flaws run so deep, he eventually disqualifies himself by blatantly disobeying God's commands. And so the aging Samuel confronts Saul and Israel. He had warned the people that they would only benefit from a king who's humble and faithful to God. Otherwise, the kings of Israel will bring ruin. So he informs Saul that God is going to raise up a new king to replace him. And so Saul's downfall begins, as God at the same time is working behind the scenes to raise up that new king. It's an insignificant shepherd boy named David. He's the least likely candidate to be king, but the famous story of David and Goliath shows that God's choice of David is not based on his family status, but simply on his radical and humble trust in the God of Israel. And so this story embodies all of the themes of Hannah's poem. Proud Saul and Goliath are brought low, while humble David is exalted. From here, we watch Saul slowly descend into madness, while David rises to power. So David starts working for Saul as a general, and he's winning all of the battles, and he's also winning all of the fame. And so Saul gets jealous, and he starts chasing David around, hunting him, trying to kill him. David's done nothing wrong, and so David simply runs and waits in the wilderness. And here we see David's true character. He has multiple opportunities to kill Saul, but he doesn't. He simply trusts that despite Saul's evil, God will raise up a king for his people. What's interesting, too, is that many of the poems of David that you find in the book of Psalms are linked to this very period of his life, and they all express the same attitude of trust. And so this section of the book ends with Saul coming to a grisly death after losing a battle with the Philistines. 1 Samuel tells some of the most intricate, well-told stories you find anywhere in the Bible, and the characters Saul and David, they're portrayed very realistically. And the author's putting them forward as character studies so that you can find yourself in them. So in Saul's story, we see a warning. It's crucial that we reflect on our own character flaws and how they harm us and other people. And with God's help, we need to humble ourselves and deal with our dark side so that Saul's story doesn't become ours. David, on the other hand, is presented as an example of patience and trust in God's timing in our lives. And so he's running in the wilderness, being chased by Saul. David had every reason to think that God had abandoned him, but that's not what he thinks. And so David's story encourages us to trust that despite human evil, God is working out his purposes to oppose the proud and to exalt the humble. And that's what 1 Samuel is all about.
Let's pray as Jesus taught, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, we're all here after the thunderstorm last night. That's good. Good morning. The reading today is from Samuel chapter 3, verses 1 through 18. And I left my reading glasses home, but bear with me. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, Samuel, Samuel, and he said, Here I am. And ran to Eli and said, Here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call, lie down again. So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, Samuel. Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, Here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call, my son, lie down again. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, Here I am, for you called me. Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there, calling as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, Speak, for your servant is listening. Then the Lord said to Samuel, See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew. Because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever. Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also. If you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him."
I suspect that not too many of you have had a chance to go up in the attic space above this room. If you have, though, you know that it can be an interesting place. Perhaps one of the most fascinating things you can see up there is the remnants of the Victorian mahogany decorations that were original to this room when this church was first built. You also would see the old post and beam construction, timbers that are 10-inch square. Those timbers have been up there for 170 years, but to get that big, they were probably 100 years old when they were cut. So think about that. A tree that started life somewhere around 1750 is holding up the roof here today. There are also things in the attic that are a little more modern. There's a motorized bell clapper. Most of you know that you actually flip a switch in the other room to make the bell ring. That motorized bell clapper is modern by comparison to the beams. It was put there in the 1940s and is there still in use today. And then, of course, there are the air handlers and controls that make the air conditioning work. And there's even modern fiber optic cables that make the cell phone emitters and the belfry work. So a lot of history going on up there. Now I'm thinking about all of that because it talks about the progression of time. I wonder if the people who originally founded this church could have imagined what it would become. I have a current interest, nearly an obsession really, about those moments in our lives when we make what seems like small and inconsequential decisions that only later have momentous consequences. As you know, I've experienced the death of two parents in these last few years, and in the summing up that is inevitable at times like that, I've been able to piece together some of these sorts of unexpected outcomes. Some of these are ones that we all know. The decision to try a musical instrument yields a joy-filled career in music. The decision to try tobacco at age 15 sometimes, unfortunately, yields lung cancer at 70. The decision to follow a less worn path yields a lifelong love of hiking. In the case of my parents, the decision to just start putting a few dollars away in their younger days resulted in a multi-million dollar fortune now. Perhaps the path of less traveled leads us into a lifelong love of hiking, or perhaps that path less traveled leads us knee-deep into a swamp. That can happen too. We can't always know what awaits us on the other side of a closed door or down that less trodden path. At each of those points in our lives, we have to pray and think and decide and act. In this story from the Hebrew Bible that we've been telling this morning, young Samuel hears a voice, and he assumes that it's his mentor Eli who's in the next room. Each time Samuel rises and goes to Eli, remember Eli's vision is poor, and he says, "Here I am, Master," and Eli says, "It wasn't me. Go back to bed." But after the third time, Eli suspects that the boy Samuel is actually hearing the voice of God and tells him to acknowledge that and to listen to what God is telling him. Eli tells Samuel to say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." What God has to say, it turns out, isn't good news for Eli or his family. For you see, Eli and his sons are priests. But these sons have behaved badly in that role, and Eli, rather than remove them from that job, has instead benefited from their misbehavior. Now, Eli is probably a good man, but he made a choice at one of those decision points that we were just talking about. One of those key decisions that seems small at the moment, but turns out to be pretty momentous. He chose to stand with those doing wrong. And now, he could not have known what the consequence would be. Today, my friends, our beloved congregation is in a moment of self-discovery. Today, we embark on a journey of possibility. We set out on a road with many junctions and many tight turns and many decisions ahead. Going to be complicated, but many worthy journeys are complicated. We can take comfort that we are on a road that has been well traveled. Our siblings and other congregations have made this trip before, and so have we. So have we. It's a road best traveled with a plan, and along the way there will be discoveries, some good, some not so much. There always are. Here are some likely examples of discoveries that we've made in just the last 18 months before this date. If you were here last Sunday, you might have noticed that there were three cameras recording the service. We had viewers literally from across the country watching this service live, something before the pandemic we had never even imagined that we could do. Today, there's an expectation that a wedding or a funeral in here will be live streamed so people who can't get here can still participate and be part of it. And we've done that. Churches all over the place are doing that. And 18 months ago, we couldn't have imagined that. Today, there's an expectation that we offer Wi-Fi internet access. Now, maybe Most of you don't happen to be using that now, but I know some of us are. And the young people that we hope to bring here will just automatically assume that we have it, because that's how the world works today. Today, there's an expectation that we offer youth education. It will be essential to those young families that we hope to bring to our church. Today, there's an expectation that we offer a prophetic moral voice in the world, even if some of us don't want to, even if some feel that that's not our role. And of course, there will be things that we can't anticipate. We'll find strengths that we didn't know we had, and we'll find weaknesses that will threaten to break us. What is certain is that we will need each other. We're going to need each other. We're going to need each other as the body of Christ. We will all need to do our part, be it to lead, be it to work, be it to pray, be it to debate, be it to vote. Everyone has a vital role in what happens in the weeks and months ahead. My friend, today the prophetic voice of the church needs to be heard in the world more than ever. I'm here to tell you that I am never more convinced of the vital role that the church fills in society right now. You are the body and hands and voice of Christ, standing in the breach where God's love, with God's love as your abundant gift to the world. I call upon all of you to deploy your hands, your hearts, your voices, and your votes in the service of God's call. But, at a congregation, we're at a moment of discernment now. So I ask us, are we Samuel? Are we a people eagerly listening for God to tell us what we should do and be? Listening carefully for the voice calling in the night? Are we ready to follow that voice where it leads us? My prayer for us is that we are. There is much work ahead, my friends. It will be hard at times, and it will seem too slow at times. But this is not stasis. We are not frozen, and we are not on pause. All of our missions continue. We continue. And we will continue to gather and to love each other and to love the world and to do the work that God has placed before us. And we will listen. We will listen for that voice calling in the night. Samuel. Samuel. Speak, God, for your servants are listening. Praise be to God, my friends. Amen. May the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Here we are, God. It's us. In this time of change and seeming uncertainty, we know that we can rely on you. You, God, are our rock, our foundation. Here we are, God. It's us. We have to rely on each other now more than ever. Help us to speak clearly, hear openly, discern broadly, and care deeply. You are our strength, God, the steady hand on our helm. Here we are, God. It's us. We need patience now. The road ahead is long, but we walk it to your glory. Help us to walk with our association and our conference and our neighbor churches and with each other. We and they are all your children, God. We are all family. Here we are, God. It's us. Hear our concerns that we raise up in silence now. Soothe us, heal us, help us, guide us, illumine us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There are several announcements in your bulletin today. The Middlesex Association is asking prayers for the Second Congregational Church of Middle Haddam. Who knew that Middle Haddam had two congregational churches? And the Haddam Neck Congregational Church, who ask for prayers as they explore what they can do in trusting God despite their smallness. We also have those on our prayer list, which you can read there. And remember that November 21st will be our Making a Difference Sunday of Service and Stewardship Sunday. And I know Mary Lawrence wants to talk a little bit about that.
I just wanted to remind everybody, as you saw in the bulletin, of that next Sunday is we're going to be putting together our meals for the Thanksgiving dinner that goes out to needy families in the community. We are still in need of money, so that anybody who is willing to donate towards this effort, it would be greatly appreciated. You can make out your check in any amount you wish. A meal does cost about $60, but we will accept $5, so as well as $500. If you could do that, and on your check, please make note that it's for the Thanksgiving meal. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Lawrence. Are there other people who have announcements?
Yes, and then after the Making a Difference activities that we do next Sunday will be Stewardship Sunday, where we'll be making brunch for everybody, so bring your appetite. And also, it's in lieu of our normal worship service, and as we do this, the Making a Difference bag stuffing, we'll be singing Thanksgiving hymns, and Sue Saltis will be accompanying us too. And again, hope you can all make it to the Stewardship Brunch, bring your appetites, and should be fun. We have the Hilltop Four singing with us for entertainment also, so look forward to seeing everyone there. Oh, Millicent? I don't think so. I'm hoping everybody who's here today will be here next Sunday. Maybe a little late, but we'll just plan on what we have. Thank you.
Other announcements? All right, well, if you'll rise, we'll sing our final hymn, I should have my eyes on that number. Morning is Broken, read hymn number 38. Samuel, Samuel. My friends, as we go out into the world and resume our busy lives, make sure that we take time to listen for God. It may well be the most important thing you hear all week. And now, may the Lord, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you each day and evermore. Amen.
Sure have.